hang on, are you going to be able to see my shoes?
No. Why, do you wear special ones?
Well, I've got different sorts of shoes depending on the mood, right?
I'm Will from Montgomery. I'm the Chief Technology Officer here at Thought Machine. And basically every day I spend working on our core products, which is core banking and payments, and the technology stack that we've picked and all the teams that make it possible.
I'm Paul Taylor, I'm founder and CEO of Thought Machine. I do all the regular CEO things as one would expect, but my particular areas of focus are strategy and culture.
I would say in a sort of nuanced answer, most people would consider their product excellent. Amazon, I think, consider delivery service as part of their product.
Yes.
And delivery time. And so everyone picks a set of dimensions on which they deem product quality to be put. We picked a different set, and one of the strongest ones in our one is design and architecture. And so we care a lot about how well the product can be used, the aesthetics and the joy of using it, and also the cleanliness or the cleanness of the design and how well it abstracts the basic problem. And most people in enterprise software don't value the same things we value. They don't value nice design. They value, for example, all the features the customer might have ever wanted, and that ends to a different, that produces a different end result than we produce. And so we believe, you know, our product is excellent against a very formal set of criteria here, which we, you know, sort of state and use to sort of guide all our work as well, which is those six dimensions of product quality that we have. So
yeah, and when people talk about product quality and product excellence, too often they just put it out there and then they don't go any further. So somebody will say that's a, you know, it's a high quality hotel or a handbag or a car or something like that, but they can't really go any further. And then other people equate quality with reliability. So when people talk about quality assurance, often a big part of what they're talking about is reliability, or the opposite of the situation where the product fails. So, but to be clear, we don't want to just have it out there as a single phrase or anything. So we dug deep and we said that there's particular aspects of product quality in which we want to be excellent in. Will said the first one is design. And by design, there's too much in the industry that sort of works, but it's a hodgepodge of features. And it's very complex. It's very difficult to learn. It's very difficult to adjust. And so we believe in a very long tradition of engineering that there is a thing called design, an industrial design, and it applies to software just as it applies to bridges or cars or anything like that. And that we believe that design is something that is kind of it's a guiding principle, but it's also something that wins in the end, because it means the product is simpler and it engenders delight in the end user, and that is a very commendable name and a commendable goal. And it's very, very desirable in the with our clients.
Yeah, and I think that in general, the focus on design, that our quality dimensions more closely resemble a consumer product where there's high amounts of competition, and the design is something that everyone feels. So, you know, most of the very good enterprise software comes from a consumer background first, where it's competed against things, you know, even the Google Workspaces, which I think actually is an excellent enterprise piece of software now, mm-hmm. came from a load of consumer products where they competed in the open market against other email providers and everything until they got the right package together. And so what we want to do is just skip the first bit and design the enterprise software as if we are competing against people who've got excellent products along the design and aesthetics front as well. So that basically when we end up with the final result, we're so far ahead of the other enterprise competition that it, you know, is striking difference. I think the metaphor spaghetti code implies a tangled mess, effectively. And I assume the alternative is a lasagna code or something.
Yes.
Where it's been well structured, right? I don't think it's a good metaphor. I think the best, a better metaphor is building a house or building a large building, whereby if you employed people with no architect and showed them a picture of what it should be and had 10 builders and trades working at the same time, you would end up with lots of problems because they haven't got the same picture in their head, things wouldn't work together, and the end result would be a shambolic mess. And then if you try to extend that over time as well, keep adding extensions to it, the end result will be sort of, an unaesthetic mess with probably a lot of structural problems that you didn't want to uncover. And that's roughly like building software. A lot can be done at the start, firstly by well organizing the teams and having clear designs and architectures for what they're going to do, so the problem is well partitioned, people cooperate it on the production rather than live independently. But then also you can never get away from the over time. As the system changes over time, the requirements generally change. We want to try and do more things. It wasn't known about when we designed the first system. And so the only two things you can do are to architect it as well as you can for extensibility later by using good abstractions and common libraries, solid foundations in the building example. Or the second one is by tearing down the building and starting again at the appropriate time. And sometimes what we try to do is draw the line whereby the current implementation of the system is based on assumptions about the world that have changed so substantially that it is more productive to start again and re-implement everything as it was and build on a better, solid, more foundation. Because now you realize the building actually has to be 20 stories tall instead of 2 stories tall, and what we built before will never support the weight. And so taking that is very tough, because obviously it means that at some point we need to make sure that the customers are still seeing positive output from their software every time they update it. But under the hood, there should be a fundamental shift. And so that's not being afraid to be able to take those decisions and do that stops the spaghetti code from being a problem, basically.
Yeah, we use a term called the sublinear. So basically, as the number of lines in the code grow and the team grows, what you cannot have is a superlinear complexity growth, which means that as more people, because if the number of people is growing like this and the complexity in the code is growing like this, then as more people go on, it'll go up and up and up and up, and then it'll just basically explode, and you will never be able to get it back. So as a minimum, you have to have that as you write more and more code, it cannot add to the overall perceived complexity of the system divided by the number of lines. All right? That has to be constant, or it has to be lower. And if you can keep that, that means that you've got control of your code base. Now, there's various things you can do to help this. So first of all, we have a very limited set of programming languages, and that we have standards on the programming languages. As Will just said, that the when you look at the code, it looks as if it's written by one person. You don't have different styles or different views about how to do it. And then it's all in the same place. Then it all is rigorously tested. We have unit tests, we have end-to-end tests, we have a whole test suite that tests it for problems. It is regularly reviewed. It is reviewed, every change is reviewed, and then the system is reviewed. And so everything you can do to increase the health of the code and keep it healthy and where it should be is done. And then Will says, inevitably, part of the agile style mindset is that when you start out a problem and start building it, you don't really know what the outcome should be, but the act of building it increases your understanding. And as you do it, you can adjust and go on. But it's not perfect. I mean, many times you get to how a system has been built and you go, that was such a good lesson, we now know a better way of doing it. And then you can go and you can refactor the code from which can, I term the covers just tidying up all the way down to a bit of rip and replace. But if you know what the code should be doing, and if you know what state it's in, and if you've got confidence about its health, then you can be, you have the confidence to be able to make changes and know the impact those changes are going to have.
Yeah. I think fundamentally we don't agree with Thought Machine doesn't agree with the statement that speed and reliability or quality are against each other, robustness. In our quality, product quality dimensions, we don't value speed of delivery the same as we value product quality. So there's not, if they ever were in conflict, we would pick a quality outcome over rushing stuff out to begin with. And so it's easy for us to say, producing a quality outcome, putting thought into the work, both produces a better end result and mitigates downstream problems, which will eventually cause more reduction in productive capacity, more toil on people in general. And sometimes in Thought Machine, even we do see new managers and new tech leads try to make the same argument in their head where they say, well, maybe if I skip the design for this one, it'll be okay, I'll get it done very, very fast. And nearly in every case, the end result takes longer than they would like. And had they done the design, they would have got the right feedback to correct their approach and they would have saved time in the end. And nearly everyone has this same realization that actually they're not in conflict. And in fact, they're very much the same approach. And so we approach it in the way that we always favor thoughtful implementation and design of things, even if it takes longer at that stage, because we believe in the long term, even if it only takes 2 years, because it will pay back to us in reduced incidents, fewer failing tests, easier integrations in the future, and a better overall design for the customers.
In the legacy industry that we're disrupting, they take a different approach. So in project management or the delivery of products, there's often the quality triangle, which is time and cost and quality. And basically, so you pick two and the other one's a determinant. And so, which is true for particular pieces of work, but not for repeat processes, as I already said. So the issue is, if you've got a fixed cost, and cost is a proxy for the number of people. So if you've got five people in the team and you give them a month, there is only so much that can be produced.